Oh, hello. Welcome to my wolf den. Come join me by the fire. As an animal myself, I've been thinking about the animals who are present at Jesus' birth. So I'm going to talk about animal ethics and the Christian tradition today. I'm Katav, and this is Furmaneutics. One of my favorite songs to listen to around Christmas time is Morten Lauridsen's arrangement of the old Christian chant, O Magnum Mysterium. I discovered this chant because Lauridsen's version of it is absolutely gorgeous. But after listening to it for a while, I was really drawn to the words as well. The chant begins, O Magnum Mysterium et Admirabile Sacramentum, ut animalia viderent Dominum natum jacentem in presepio. In English, O great mystery and wonderful sacrament, that animals might see the newborn Lord lying in a manger. This text celebrates the animals at the birth of Jesus, not the wise men or shepherds or star or those other things we might expect, but rather the lowly animals. Believe it or not, the New Testament actually makes no mention of any animals here. Of the four canonical gospels, only two contain stories about Jesus' birth, Matthew and Luke. These two accounts differ greatly, and neither one has animals surrounding the newborn Jesus. Luke's version of the story, however, does provide a logical explanation for domesticated animals there. Nativity scenes usually show Jesus being born in a stable because there's no room at the inn, but this is probably not what Luke is imagining. It's not like there's no vacancy at the Marriott Marquis, so they have to sleep in the parking garage. Instead, Joseph and Mary are going to Bethlehem because it is his family home, so they're probably staying with family. And the word traditionally translated inn probably refers to the usual living space for the family. So in Luke's mind, they're running out of space in the upstairs place for humans, so Jesus stays on the lower level of the house with the animals. It's not a story about an inhospitable innkeeper, but rather one about a crowded first century Judean family home. But regardless, even if animals aren't specifically mentioned here, Luke 2:7 does portray Mary lying the baby Jesus in a manger, that is, a feeding trough. So the presence of animals here is not a huge leap of imagination. The specific animals that Christian tradition has placed with Jesus are typical domesticated creatures that would logically be in an ancient Palestinian home. But two of the most common are the ox and the donkey. This is likely due to Christians' appreciation of the much older Hebrew Bible verse, Isaiah 1:3, which reads, "The ox knows its owner, and the donkey its master's crib. But Israel does not know. My people do not understand." In its original context, the prophet Isaiah is saying even irrational animals know their master. But Israel is refusing to recognize its own master, God. For later Christian interpreters, the verse comes to indicate the ox and donkey's recognition of Jesus as their master lying in a crib. The original author, Isaiah, would have had no knowledge of this Jesus guy coming hundreds of years later, but this is certainly a creative rereading from within a Christian perspective. Now that we've placed some animals in the scene, I want to return to the chant, O Magnum Mysterium, again. What is most special to me here is that it remarks that the great and wonderful mystery occurring in this story is that animals see Jesus. The eyes of oxen and donkeys rest upon this newborn human and take in this sight. The French philosopher Jacques Derrida talks a lot about being seen by animals. In one particularly famous passage, he recalls how one time he stepped out of his shower to find his cat looking at him. There he stood, naked and exposed, laid bare before the gaze of this other creature. He can never know what this cat is thinking about him, but the question is worth asking. For Derrida, the problem with most Western philosophy is that our great philosophers have not allowed themselves to be seen by an animal. He doesn't mean this literally. Of course, some animal looked at Descartes or Heidegger at some point in their lives. But most philosophy has embraced human exceptionalism and considered non-human animals to be lesser beings, often with destructive effects. The injustices that we commit against our animal neighbors, for Derrida, are because we haven't allowed ourselves to truly be seen by them. What would it mean for us to pause and consider that there is a consciousness lying behind the eyes of our cats and dogs? What would we change about our world if we could step down from being rulers over oxen and donkeys and instead allow ourselves to be the objects of their gaze? This is what comes to mind in the Christmas season for me. Even though the Bible doesn't give us any explicit depictions of animals at Jesus' birth, Christian tradition has gone on to imagine this scene creatively, even going as far as to celebrate the Christ child being seen by animals. Now, I don't care if you're a Christian or not, but I am truly fascinated by the ethical implications here. If Jesus can be seen by animals, could we also do the same? Can we consider the ox and donkey's point of view? Can we work for a more just existence for the non-human animals we share this world with? Thank you for joining me today. If you enjoyed this video, help me out by liking and subscribing. If you're a Christian, I wish you a Merry Christmas. If not, I wish you a wonderful Hanukkah or Kwanzaa, and certainly a Happy New Year. Take care and spread some cheer to the furry friends in your life.